Hello and welcome to the Indian Writers Forum. Today we have with us the poet and translator Arvind Krishna Mehrotra. Arvindji, many, many thanks for agreeing to do this interview.
Yeah, well, thanks. Thanks for having me to this.
So this is his. This is a very early edition of his translation of Prakrit love poetry, Gatha Saptasati, from the Gatha Saptasati. Arvindji, you've translated these poems from the Sanskrit. And now there's a certain need to make Sanskrit, like give certain importance to Sanskrit as a translator of Sanskrit, as a reader of Sanskrit. How do you place these arguments now?
You know, that's the translation from the Prakrit.
Sorry, it's from the Prakrit.
You know, if they were to introduce Sanskrit in schools, I think that might be I've said this before, but it might be a far better way of beginning your day with some erotic verse. You know, if you are, let's say, in class 7 or 8, and instead of singing Bande Mataram or whatever the slogans are, I'm saying if you were to begin, let's say, with a poem from the Gatha Saptasati, where the mother is telling the daughter that when you get married and go to your husband's house, if you can't find another man, you'll have to sleep with him also. You know, that's this tragedy you too will have to bear, of sleeping with your husband. Now, if these values were being sort of inculcated in our children from a very young age, I think it might be it might lead to a far healthier society, rather than, you know, girls growing up in a society where they have to do a silly thing like Karwa Chauth. You know, so I think, you know, if they were to introduce Sanskrit shlokas and Sanskrit poetry from a very early age, I think it might make a huge difference to this society. Or, for instance, there is another Gatha Saptasati poem where this a woman in old age is remembering the time when she went to the temple and she prayed to this image of she didn't pray. Now she's praying in her old age to the image of Ganesh. But in her youth, they went to the temple to screw around. Now, temples were places for fucking. I'm saying that's what temples were for. I'm saying these poems are 2,000 years old. And she's saying that we use that image of Ganesh as a pillow. And now I've come here to worship. So he's telling Ganesh, now you'll be satisfied, you know, that at least I've made amends. Now, so a lot of things might change. I'm saying we might start looking at the world very differently. Right. Were we to look at it through Prakrit eyes or through Sanskrit eyes? But I'm sure that they, the people who are for Sanskrit, this is not the Sanskrit they mean. They would mean whatever they mean by it. But so as such, if they were to introduce some of what is really the Indian tradition, if they do want to talk about it, but then they'll be running for cover. You know, that's the whole problem. So they will not. This is not what they're going to. So I don't know what they're going to put into that course. But in any case, you know, when I was a student, Sanskrit was compulsory. I did my education in Madhya Pradesh. But of course, one didn't learn anything. So you can make it compulsory. But I mean, I'm sure we all learned Hindi compulsorily. But how much Hindi do we read? I mean, if you force things down through this sort of educational curriculum, you basically develop a hatred for the language.
Right.
You know, I'm saying you. So the same thing will happen with Sanskrit. I mean, just as they killed Hindi by filling the courses
with Hindi. I was interested to, if you could tell us a little bit about the time in the 60s when the Angrezi Hatao Andolan was on, and you, who is also a translator from the Hindi, so Now when you look back at that time, and now there's again this thinking Hindi has to be made the national language. So
I hope that, you see, that's, Hindi should, there is no national language, there is something called the official language from what I, so, and there are, so, and, so we don't have a national language, and let us keep it that way. And in any case, it's, it, they can't impose a language on people. You know, the, you think, you know, they're going to impose Hindi on Tamil Nadu, they, you know, they're, it's not going to happen. When you see that, when we started writing, I'm talking of the mid 60s. Now let's not forget, we, independence was not even 20 years behind us then. You know, we had, it was a newly independent country, and some of that old idea of one nation, one flag, one language, which had a purpose in the 30s or 20s. But by 60s, it had lost its. Some of it was still there. So that was the, you know, the period when this whole thing about English being removed, because some of that nationalist ideas were still, had not lost the force. And also, I think in 1950 they had decided that English will be there for the next 15 years. And then it will be removed and it will be replaced by another language. Now, I don't know whether it's a national language or official language. So 1965 when it started happening. And that's when Nehru stepped in and said that no, English will not be removed. It will continue to be one of the languages in use. And so there were anti-Hindi riots in the south. I've written about it in my introduction to the history of Indian literature. There were anti-English riots in the south.
Anti-Hindi riots.
Anti-Hindi, and there were anti-English in the north. So, and we remember our nameplates outside houses, the number plates of cars, the shop signs, they were all painted black if they were in English. So, but then that, Dhumal wrote this poem, you know, on the language question. I forget the title of it. Bhasha ki raat, I'm forgetting what the, but so when you were writing in the mid 60s, everyone would tell us that English is on its way out, because, you know, things were still fluid at the time. But if they're doing it now, you know, then it's a very different kind of nationalism. So that was directly linked to the independence movement, but this is not linked to anything, you see. But they won't. I'm saying this is an impossible idea. You can't push language down people's throats. I don't think it's going to happen.
But I mean, there's such good intention to do this thing for Hindi, to do this thing for Sanskrit, for Prakrit, and learn our old traditions. You have been working on with these traditions in a very active and creative manner, not as a kind of not in just in academies or like as a mode of teaching, but as a kind of recreating that space.
Yeah.
Your translations of Kabir, from the Gatha Saptasati.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you think people in our country really pay attention to our languages? Like, even outside of this whole political conundrum that we are in now, but outside of that, since you have been translating for so many years.
You see, I think languages have been sort of devalued when we ourselves have devalued our languages, partly by not doing enough research in them. I'm saying this is a thing which one constantly hears, that you don't have enough historians who are working in Hindi, let's say. I'm not talking of Bangla, I mean, that's another, you know. Of course, they have historians working only in Bangla, but in Hindi, you can't name half, you know, five historians who have done work which is recognized by other historians, and I'm sure the same would be in Gujarati. I'm not very sure, but you know, or in Odia for that matter. So there is, I think it's, you know, it's not just enough to create poetry and fiction in these languages.
Right.
And so all the academic volumes which students will use, you know, they are all in English. I'm saying, if you're doing your MA in history at any university, I'm saying, how much of Hindi will you be able to, books will you be able to find, or in political science? The problem also is you don't get students studying these languages. I'm saying, we have just, the Indian languages are at the bottom of the pile. It's a very strange situation where the brightest minds go into engineering, and or into medicine, or they do that and then they do some business degree. So who is doing the sort of MA in Hindi or MA in Persian? And let's not forget, this not only Hindi, that, you know, universities should be teaching Prakrit also. They should be teaching Ardhamagadhi, to say nothing of Persian and Arabic. But the Arabic departments would have closed down in this country. I'm sure the Persian departments have closed down.
There are few here and there.
Very few, but you know, but for instance, in Allahabad, they used to have Pali, they used to, but once the teacher died, you know, there was no replacement. And people have been talking about this, not only the decline of the classical languages over here, and I think slowly the decline of these other languages, of our own modern languages. Because if you can get admission in MA English, why will you seek admission into MA Hindi? I'm saying, this hierarchy of languages is a peculiarly Indian situation. And by denigrating English, that's not going to help. I'm saying, you should just make it more worthwhile for students to be learning their own languages. The other side of this is that there's no research being done in the Hindi departments of the kind that they do in the West. You know, someone like Francesca Orsini. I'm saying, she wrote a book called The Hindi Public Sphere. Hindi Public Sphere should not have been done by someone at SOAS. It should have been done over here. So it's the condition of the libraries, the working conditions, Surdas has been done by Jack Hawley. But so why couldn't we have produced an edition of Surdas with all the variations, all the entire, so it's a Harvard Oriental series done by someone sitting at, so it's not only that we don't do any research in Hindi of that caliber, but we are also unaware of what is going on. And they leave us out half a dozen people. But let's say you think someone in Allahabad would even have heard of the kind of research which is being done in America and in England on Hindi literature, both modern and medieval. So it's a very strange, it's a very odd, I don't think so, it's happened in any other language, that you have people from other parts of the world researching, of whom you yourself are unaware.